Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to invite to the stage Mr. Peter Meyers, founder and president of Stand and Deliver. I also pleased to announce we just received books of Peter Meyers' books as we speak. It's available to you as a gift. You can find it on your way out. Peter has kindly offered to sign it, if you wish. Please, Peter, can you join us on stage?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. Salam alaikum. As many of you know, our magazines and newspapers are in trouble. They're having a hard time as more and more readers turn to their tablets and their phones to get the news. Newspapers are asking big questions about relevance. So the Times of London conducted a survey 6-8 months ago, and they sent out a questionnaire to something like 10,000 people. And one of the questions on the survey was, what is your greatest fear? They got back the results, and it turns out that snakes, spiders, and earthquakes ranked pretty low on the list. In fact, death itself was number two, and number one was speaking in public, which of course means most people would rather die than make a speech. If you follow the logic of this, faced with giving a eulogy, most people would rather be in the coffin. And yet we know that one of the most important skills for any leader in any business is the ability to communicate, to be able to communicate not just facts, not just data, not just ideas, but stories. And one of the challenges that a lot of us face is, how do we ensure that what we say sticks? Because it turns out that most of what we say in these 10,000 words a day and the hundreds of conversations that we have a week, most of what we say, people don't remember. People don't remember what we say, but they never forget how you made them feel. And one of the things that stories do is they help us feel. They help us connect with each other emotionally. In fact, here's what the research is showing us. At Princeton, they recently did a study where they hooked up a bunch of probes to look at two people's brains while one person told a story. And it turns out that while a person tells a story, it lights up certain parts of the brain, the verbal, the abstract, and the emotional part of the brain of the storyteller. Here's the interesting thing. It also lights up the other person's brain. In fact, if you diagram the lighting in the two brains, they're almost identical. The mirror neurons, which is where we get our empathy, tend to connect in ways that bring people along with our thinking and our emotions when we tell a story. And one of the challenges that people have when they tell stories is they tend to stay away from them because they don't want to be overly sentimental. They say, Peter, I'd love to tell stories, but in my organization, it would seem to be mawkish or overly emotional. Or, Peter, I'd love to tell a story, but it takes too long. In fact, when most of us hear stories, we'd say that's one of the big complaints we have. It takes too long to get to the point. Or sometimes we hear a story and we go, okay, it was a good story, but what does it have to do with what you were talking about? There isn't really a point. So over the next few minutes, and I mean few minutes, we're going to work very, very quickly here, I'm going to share with you some of the basic principles of good storytelling. And one of the things I'm going to suggest here is that you don't need a good story. Most of us are waiting for this great story in order to tell it. The fact is, you can tell a story out of almost anything if you know the right ingredients. But what's important here is that as leaders, it's not a question of whether or not to tell a story or not. Given the levels of engagement, given the need to move people, given the need to create transformational results, you couldn't choose otherwise. You have to be great storytellers. You have to figure out how to put a human face on the things that you're trying to influence. The question is whether you're telling the stories well or not. So this is going to be interactive. This is going to be participatory. It's not going to be so much of a lecture. I'm going to ask you guys to jump in, because anybody who's achieved anything noteworthy in their life has done so with the help of a mentor, a coach, or a teacher. And over the next 15 minutes, I'd like to be that coach for all of you. How does that? Yes or yes?
Yeah.
All right, good. So here's a core principle of telling stories. This is not a story. That's flat information. This is a story. A story has change. A story is unpredictable. A story has structure. So one of the first things we have to look at is how do we create structure in a story? Now, there's a universal structure that was created a long time ago by our friend Mr. Aristotle, the Aristotelian structure. And almost all stories follow this structure in one form or another. And the structure is basically this, that a story starts on a platform, once upon a time, or yesterday, on my way to Saudi Arabia, or I was with my family, or we were sitting in a meeting. There is a basic platform, and then the platform gets tilted. And there's a series of problems, challenges, difficulties that the protagonist faces. And then there's a restoration of balance at the very end. That's a good story. So here's what I'd like you to try. I'd like you to think of something very ordinary, an ordinary journey that you recently took. It could be a flight, it could be a vacation, it could be a meeting, it could be a visit that you had with somebody, and I'd like you to tell it without any kind of a structure, and I'd like you to tell it in 45 seconds. This is a 45-second story. So it might be, I left San Francisco, and I got on a flight to come to Saudi Arabia for my first time, and I got on a United flight, and I arrived in Paris, and I had 90 minutes to switch to get on another flight. I got on the next flight, and I arrived in Jeddah. When I got to Jeddah, I had to find my driver. I couldn't find him at first, and then I found him, and then I came here. No structure, just a flat story. That was about 22 seconds. That's all I want you to do. Don't try to tell a good story. Don't try to tell a good story. Keep it nice and boring. All right, everybody up for this? Some of you are looking like this is a trick. It's not a trick. Just tell a boring story. Don't wait for something brilliant. Everybody on your feet, find a partner. You've got 45 seconds. Person A will tell person B. Person B is the taller of the two of you. Person A tells person B, and then person B tells person B. Here we go, real quick. Everybody stand. Have a stand. Nobody's exempt. You guys all have to try it. Tell the person a story. Basic story. A journey that you took. Just a journey. A simple story about a journey. And he tells it. Then switch. And switch. So B tells A. Switch sides. the other person tells the story? You both told it? Good, you're ahead. Okay, so you guys stay with me here, stay with me. You can have a seat for just a moment, and I'll have you get up again. So that's a flat story. That's this. So the first element of a great story is that the story has a structure. It has a middle and an end. The beginning sets the platform. The middle is where we have a tilt, where we have chaos or a challenge, where some kind of a difficulty showed up. The difficulty can be internal, as in a fear, a challenge yourself, or it can be external. It can be a monster, an enemy, a government, a budget, a boss. It can be something outside of you, or it can be in nature, a hurricane, a disaster. We heard a lot of great stories. In fact, if you think about what you remember over these 2 days, most of what you're going to remember are the stories, not the facts. But when a story is told with facts inside of it, it gets wrapped and it goes to a higher level in the brain. So what I'm going to ask you to do is add the first element of a good story, which is structure. So you're going to tell the story with a beginning, a middle, and an end. So I took the plane from San Francisco to Paris. Everything was fine. I went from Paris and I arrived in Jeddah and I couldn't find my driver anywhere. I was completely lost. I didn't speak the language. And all I saw were a lot of people in long white robes saying, "Do you need a taxi? Do you need a taxi?" And no matter where you go in the world, people say, "Never take rides from those guys." And I'm standing there, I'm biting my fingernails, go, "What do I do now?" Now we have the beginning of a story. All right? So, person A, you're going to find a new person, and you're going to tell the same story, only this time add structure. Platform, tilt, and then resolution. Here we go. We're going to work very quickly, 30 seconds each. Have a stand real quick. Find a new person that you haven't talked to yet, real quick. And switch roles, so both people go, switch, take turns. So what did you notice? The story got a little more interesting, a little bit of dimension to it. The other person probably started to lean in and go, this is getting good. So there's a beginning, there's a middle, and an end. And it has to go up, and it has to go down, and then it has to sweep up again. All good stories have a structure. No structure, no story. Here's the second element of a great story. What people tend to remember are details. The details, the sensorial details that make up a story. A detail can be a visual detail, the pictures, what you see, the colors, the lighting. There are auditory details, what it like. There are kinesthetic details, what it felt like. And then there are digital details. Digital details are numbers and logic. It was 4 o'clock. We'd been on the road for 2 hours. It had been 6 hours since I'd eaten. Those are digital. And this is an important distinction when you're communicating. If you want to create rapport with somebody, you want to listen to what modality they're in. When we communicate, we always communicate in a specific modality. Now, there are other modalities too, but most people work in one of those four modalities. And they will show you what modality they're in. If you stay in that modality, if they're visual and you stay visual with them, they'll create a greater sense of connection. So if you say, how was your vacation? And somebody comes back and goes, it was great. We went skiing. We went skiing in Switzerland, and it was beautiful. The white mountains, the blue sky. I went with my wife, and we both got these new dark blue jumpsuits. And we got to the top of the mountain. I looked over, and I saw Lake Geneva. It was so beautiful. He's obviously visual. And if you say, tell me more about what it looked like, he goes, wow, I got such a great connection with this person. But if you switch modalities and you go, well, what were some of the sounds? You just broke rapport with him. But if he comes up to you and he says, I just got back from vacation. It was wonderful. We went skiing, and when I got there, it was so quiet. You could hear the snow falling down. And the snow was just right. You got that sort of shushy sound when the skis were on the snow, when it's nice and dry. And we got on the chairlift. And we could hear the wind. My wife whispered in my ear. It was so wonderful. It was like music to my ears again. He's auditory. He's in an auditory modality. If he says, listen, we got to the ski slope and it was cold. Not too cold, but cold. But we had these new jumpsuits, which kept us nice and warm. And we went up to the top of the slope. We skied for a little while, and I felt like a kid again. I felt so free as I put my arms out. I started to ski, and it was so wonderful to be there with my wife again. I was falling in love again. He's obviously kinesthetic. He's all about his feelings. If he says, we went skiing for my 10th wedding anniversary, I got these new skis, they were 163 centimeters, and we got there first, 9 o'clock sharp. We were the very first ones to get on the ski lift, and we got on the lift, and we went something like 100 meters, it wasn't that long, 6-7 minutes, and we got off, and we skied about 50 meters, and I stopped, and I looked into my wife's two blue eyes, and I said, even after 10 years, you're still my number one. He's digital. And you create a deeper connection. What's important is when you tell a story, you want to use some of these modalities. You want to use the visual, the auditory, the kinesthetic, because that's what makes it memorable. So I say, I was standing there, and all of a sudden, all these guys came up with the white robes and everything. I'm in a foreign land, and I'm getting a coffee, and I still have the baklava stuck in my teeth, and I look at this guy, and he says, come with me. He's got this deep voice. He says, I will help you. And I looked into his two eyes, and I didn't know what to do. And we started to go through this hallway, this dark hallway. And we walk into this big plush room. Those are the details that bring the listener into the story. You have 30 seconds to tell the story now with structure and a little bit of detail. The visual, the auditory, the kinesthetic, maybe a of digital. Here we go. Have a quick stand. Find a new partner and tell the story real quick. Come on, guys. Tell the same story, but add a little detail to it. And switch roles. Make sure you switch roles. 30 seconds. If you would thank your partner and have a seat, please. What did you notice when you started to add the details? What did you notice? Somebody, what did you notice? Was it easy or was it hard?
More engaging.
That's a good thing. It's harder to put the story together with the details because most of us focus on the plot. Now, this is a really interesting thing about how leaders communicate. We know what happened because we were there. So we assume if we tell everybody what happened, they'll be able to see our movie. Your job is to bring them into your movie and to figure out what relevant details you have to add. Now, here's the interesting thing. And this was first theorized by the famous film editor, Eisenstadt, the Russian film director. You don't have to add all the details. If I say, he came up to me, and he had this long mustache, Paris. Long, pointy mustache, and he had a purple hat and long, pointy shoes, holding a cigarette with a cigarette holder. Can you see the guy now? I don't have to tell you anything else. You've got a whole picture. The brain, within a fraction of a second, fills in all the details. You have to give us one or two details, and then the brain fills it in, and at that moment, our brains are lit up together. And your communication suddenly has wings. Because you're not just you're moving. Here's the next element that makes for a great story. You want to know what it is? Yes or no?
Yes.
Lean in. Mystery. surprise, suspense. It doesn't have to be creepy. It doesn't have to be violent. There just has to be something that you hold back and that you leave out. And it doesn't mean that you change the story. Life is mysterious. We don't know what's going to happen in the next 5 seconds. So when you add mystery, you're adding veracity. You're adding truthfulness. Moment to unanticipated moment. We put one foot in front of the other down the path of life. Your job is to bring it into your stories. So I arrived in Jeddah. And I've traveled all over the world. And no matter where you go, they say, never get into a taxi with all the guys who come up to you. This is my first time here. And there's guys all around. Do you need a taxi? Do you need a taxi? No, I don't. No, I don't. No, you don't. And I finally call the phone number that's on my phone, but I don't know who the other person is. And he says, where are you? I said, I'm by the coffee stand, by the baklava. He says, stay where you are. Is there a Saudi near you? I said, there are Saudis everywhere. He says, put one on the phone. And he's not sounding very friendly. I'm really nervous. I go up to this guy, I go, are you a Saudi? He goes, could he talk to you? He goes, what do you want? I said, I don't know. He wants to talk to you. I've only been in the country for about 60 seconds. And I put him on the phone, and he speaks in Arabic to him. And I'm going, He goes, okay. He says, come with me. I said, okay. And we walked down through the side of the lobby of the airport, and we go down a hallway, and then we turn left, and we go down right, and the hallway's a little bit dark, and we walk into this room, this plush room with really fancy seats. He walks me over, and he says, sit down. I sit down. And he comes back with a bottle of sparkling water and a little cookie. And he says, you stay there. Your driver's going to come in just a moment. And I said, thank you so much. Shukran. He said, listen, when I come to your country, you'll do the same. Now, I'm from New York City. You don't trust strangers. But this was my first impression here in Saudi Arabia, is that people are kind. People take care of you. People work together. And that people are generous. That's my story. But there's some mystery in there, yeah? I'm not going to have you stand and tell each other another version of this. But here's the final element of what makes a good story. A story has to have a point. It has to be relevant. The listener is always asking, so what? Why are you telling me this story? The story is intended to reinforce your point, whatever your message is. When you're able to add a human face to a story, it elevates it into a top drawer inside of the brain. The experience gets wrapped. So if we look at the anatomy, high performance engagement, it has three parts. It has what we call a ramp, an opening that demonstrates relevance to the listener. A ramp is a way of saying, I've thought about your concerns. Now, many of you as leaders are facing big challenges. You have to go out there and you have to influence people. That's a ramp. Hi, I'm Peter Meyers. I want to talk to you about what I care. That's not a ramp. That's all about me. A ramp is simply an answer to the question, why should they care about what you're about to say? If you can't answer that question in the first 30 seconds, 50% of the audience is out the door. They're not listening anymore. Your ramp gets you to a high level of elevation so that you can achieve an outcome at the end. The middle of a talk should have some kind of a structure of three. Usually it's the problem, the solution, and the investment. Or it could be, here's where we were, here's where we are, here's where we're going. Here's what happened in the market, here's what we're looking at, and here's the plan going forward. Create a structure of three. It's the most powerful structure in the world. People remember it, and you can remember it as a speaker. I'm not talking about simplifying everything and dumbing it down, because you can create nuance underneath that structure of three. You can create various levels of detail, but you want to build this in three basic parts. Most people get to this part, and they're doing pretty well. And then they turn to the audience, and they go, so, does anybody have any questions? Endings are really important because it pays disproportionate dividends on what people remember. If you think about when you go to see a movie, if the movie opens up and right out of the gate, it's exciting. There's car crashes. There's chase scenes. There's monsters. There's excitement. There's adventure. There's romance. But in the last 5 minutes, it's disappointing. When you walk out of the film and people say, how was the movie? What do you say? Don't waste your time. It's crap. You forgot. You were happy 95% of the time. You think about the opposite experience. The movie opens. Nothing's happening. Nothing's happening. Nothing's happening. Nothing. Think about some of your French films. Nothing's happening. But right at the end, it all comes together. Right. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. You walk out of the film, people say, how was the film? You say, great French film. You got to go see it. You forgot you were bored 95% of the time. But when we speak in meetings, in dialogues, when we give important presentations and speeches, we know that the opening is important because this is where you engage the listener. The middle is where the really important stuff happens if you've organized it well. But what happens is we save Q&A for the end. And I say, never end on Q&A. Never end on, always have it, but don't end there. There's three risks. One is you're doing really well, and you turn to them, you go, so what questions do you have? No questions? Not even one? Okay. Well, thank you very much for allowing me to be here. I'll get my laptop and go now. And that's what they remember. Or you say, any questions? And here he comes. There's a guy back there who's been waiting all along. He's got a goatee, a pinstripe suit, and a red pen. And he goes, yeah, I have a question for you. And here he comes, the assassin in the audience. And he doesn't really have questions. He has an agenda, which is to take you down. And question after question to discredit you. Until you finally say, can we take this offline? I'm out of time. And that's what they remember, even though the middle was pretty good. Or you say, are there questions? And say, yeah, this is interesting, but how is that going to affect our parking spots? You're going, park? What does that have to do with anything? So you get some irrelevant question from nowhere, and you still have to answer it. But on a scale of 1 to 10, you're still stuck at a 2. What you do is you save something for the very end. After the last question, you turn back and say, before I go, what I'd like to do is leave you with this. And I've seen it consistently up here. Almost everybody intuitively knows this. They've left you with a little dessert, a little crème brûlée, a little mousse au chocolat, a little something at the very end that wraps it, and that's where you put a story. That's where you put a human face. And where does that story come from with dessert? It either comes from the past, in an example of how you've achieved success in the past, or it comes from the future. So there are two kinds of stories. There are stories about breakthroughs, and there are stories about possibilities. But what they have in common is a human face. So we have a couple of minutes before I wrap up. I'd like to take any questions that you may have. Any questions about storytelling, about community? This is what we do at Stand and Deliver. We work with teams. We work with organizations on how to tell the company story, how to tell the organizational story. How do you get not only yourself, but a whole team aligned behind that vision in a way that they're out there evangelizing and telling the story in a way that moves hearts and minds? How do you take information and give it away in ways that improves the credibility and the presence of the senior team? What questions do you have? Yes.
Because they use some of these techniques.
Yeah.
My question is it something that you train for? You can be a good storyteller? How do you do that?
You're asking a trainer whether this is something that you train for. So you know you're going to get a biased answer.
How are you going to train?
Well, there's this big question. A lot of you have asked me this. Is presence and storytelling and good communication, is that something you're born with? Or is it something you learn? Something you learn. There isn't a DNA strand called storytelling, called charisma. I'll tell you this, as I said yesterday, I've had the good fortune of working with a lot of great leaders in my life. I've also worked with entertainers. And I can tell you that some of the best communicators are introverts. They're very, very quiet. In some ways, introverts make better communicators, because an introvert has to go inside. They tend to be more sensitive. They tend to be more introspective and reflective about what they say. Extroverts just talk. They talk in order to think. So it's something that you can train for, and you can get better at really fast, because here's the interesting thing. The bar is really low. All you have to do is put a few into practice, and soon you start to elevate your presence in meetings and conversations. Leaders get noticed disproportionately for their communication skills. And the really sad thing is that there are so many people who have the potential to lead, they haven't worked on this core skill, and their ideas are often never heard. There was another question.
You give the dessert before you open for Q&A.
Give the dessert after the Q&A. I'll take one more question. Okay. Take the question. Before I go, what I'd like to do is leave you with this.
But
that's the very last thing.
Okay, so how do you handle the assassin before you give the dessert? Because this is going to bring you down.
Yeah. So how do you handle the assassin? How many of you have dealt with the assassin out there? We've all had the assassin. How many of you have been the assassin, by the way? We've all had our terms. So this is a longer conversation. I'm going to try to summarize it for you in 60 seconds. How do you deal with somebody who's negative and is trying to take over the meeting, trying to take over the room? Well, here are a couple of principles. Number one, when somebody is, it's because their needs are not being met. If you can determine way, that'll take care of 75% of the time. Why do most people monopolize the discussion when they put their hand up and they tend to be know-it-alls and they tend to try to discredit you? What do they really want?
Attention.
They want attention. Their mother didn't give them enough recognition growing up. And now they're trying to get all that attention that their mom didn't give them at everybody else's expense. So if you can, say, you know what, you've brought up an excellent point, and I really appreciate your insights on this, because this is a point that we do need to discuss, and then turn away from him. Don't keep looking at him. Turn away. This is an important point. And I'm really glad you brought it up. This is an excellent idea. And then you have to answer the question. But be careful to get into a one-on-one with him. And don't repeat his negative language. If he says, you lied to us before, I don't know why you're telling us this again. How do we know you're not lying to us? Don't repeat the word lie. You don't want to say, no, we don't lie. We've never lied. We're not liars. Every time you say lie, it's like stepping in dog poop and moving it around the stage. Elevate the question and go to higher ground. This is an important question, and it has to do with how do we restore trust? Trust is neutral. My father used to say, never wrestle with a pig. You both wind up getting full of mud, but the pig likes it. My father, rest in peace. Last question. I want to be respectful of the time. Yes, please. Could somebody go back and tell these guys that their voices are coming all the way through? I'm hearing the conversation from behind stage here.
So you're in your middle of the story, and you feel that the audience are getting bored. What do you do? Do you make it shorter, or do you complete what you plan to say?
Yeah, this is an important question. What do you do if you notice that the audience is getting bored? Well, first of all, brava to you for noticing, because most people don't notice. They just keep going. To notice where your audience is at any given time, because they're constantly going to notice their breathing. If they're still and they're looking, they're interested. You have to be careful because sometimes when people look, especially senior executives, they look like this. And you start going, he hates it, he hates it, he hates it, he hates it. And it makes you nervous. Later on, he walks up and he goes, that's fantastic. This can happen in meetings, too. Some people, when they're in a neutral face, they look bored. But if they're looking, they're engaged. So what do you do when you notice they're not with you? First, you must change. If you're using any kind of a strategy in business or organizations, if your strategy doesn't work, what do you do? You change it. If the new strategy doesn't work, what do you do? You change it again. And if that doesn't work, you change it again. You must keep changing it. So you change your pace, you change your volume, you change your position closer to them. You may go from a speech to a Q&A. You may turn to Charlie. I know you've had a lot of experience with that. What are your thoughts? Get him or her engaged, especially at the conference call. But don't wind up getting into a race. If you're about to speak and they said, listen, I know we told you you were going to have 20 minutes, but now you only have two, don't go up and say, all right, I got to do this really fast, so I'm going to be talking as fast as I can and try to get through this whole thing. That's not going to work because it lowers your status. When time is short, slow down. But you have to be very sparse about what you say. So there are a variety of things to do, but you must change. But don't speed up. Don't drop your status. There's a whole concept around speaking which has to do with power. If the speaker is taking too much power, the audience perceives the speaker as arrogant. So, I'm here to talk to you about communication. You go, oh, where did this guy come from? But if I lower my status too much, good morning, everybody. It's such an honor to be here. What a pleasure. Now the audience is worried. The same thing about making mistakes. Most of us make a mistake every three sentences. When you make a mistake, what's important is you don't suffer. If you suffer, you not only suffer, but you deliver pain to the audience. So if you're up there, I'm so sorry, I made a mistake. If you suffer, they suffer more. So if you make a mistake, recover from it and get back on track. Don't make a big deal about it. The audience expects you to hold the room. Everybody get that? Too often, I'm going to get in trouble for saying this, but too often in some countries, people tend to take up too much power. They tend to come across as arrogant. Some of this can depend on the region. In some countries, we're too humble. You have to find that balance depending on the culture that you're in. But generally, most of us can take up more space in the room. All right. I think I'm going to wrap up here. It's been a long day. Before we go, I'd like to leave you with this. When you think about communication, it is the differentiator. It is the thing that breaks us free. It gets us to the next level. But most of us, at least in my experience, 25 years of working with organizations and leaders, most of us are holding ourselves back. We have wonderful ideas. We have wonderful stories. We have emotions that inspire other people. But we hide it. We keep it to ourselves in fear of embarrassment. We're spending so much time trying to make sure that we look good. I have a friend who is a circus trainer. He's a circus trainer, and he works in one of the last circuses in the U.S. that still have elephants. And he tells me that when an elephant is born in the circus, what they do is they put a chain around his ankle and they put a spike down in the ground so he doesn't run away. But as that elephant gets older, they keep the chain around his ankle and they keep the spike in the ground. Later on, this animal is thousands of pounds and huge. He still has this chain around his ankle with a little spike. He doesn't know that he could just lift up his leg and rip that thing right out of the ground. Make sure that you're not an elephant. Make sure that you're not holding yourself back. There is no spike holding you back. The world is waiting for your ideas. The world is waiting for your heart. There are people out there that need to be inspired. And as you leave here with all of these wonderful ideas that have been shared, be generous. Give it away. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very much.